When reports of a cyber attack appear in the news, the first thing people think about is how much damage was done, how much money was stolen, and most importantly, who carried out the attack. Less consideration is given to the deeper questions, such as those relating to understanding the technical aspects of the intrusion or how and why the attack happened. But these elements are the ones that can enable victims to build stronger defenses and prevent possible future attacks. In this video, you will learn about how technical attribution is provided, what challenges and limitations it faces, and why accurate and more transparent technical attribution is the key to future cyberspace stability. Could you please tell me what is technical attribution?
Sure. So technical attribution is the work that we do in the great team, and it consists in looking at the various evidence that we get from various sources but that pertain to cyber incidents and investigations that are going on, and we try to connect those incidents that might appear to be separated or have nothing to do with each other and try to find what links might exist between them. And so we try to work not with actual actors, which could be countries or intelligence services, but we work with virtual threat actors that are groups, virtual clusters that we name, for instance, APT1 or SOFACY and names like this.
And what does attribution process consist of?
In order to achieve those technical attributions that we do, we look at a number of things, such as, for instance, the tools that are used by the attackers. So an example of this is if we find a backdoor on a victim machine that we know is only used by a single actor, then if we find this backdoor later on another machine, then it stands to reason that this attacker that was involved in the second attack was probably the same one as in the first. So this is one way that we can connect those types of incidents together. Another thing that we tend to look at is the infrastructure. So for instance, servers that are being used for common control purposes, sometimes between attacks, then the attackers will reuse machines that they already own to establish communications with their viruses. And if they do, then we kind of are able to figure out that whoever owns the server has to be behind those two or maybe more attacks. And finally, we also work on weaker type of evidence, such as the kind of methodologies that the attackers use, what type of attack vectors they tend to favor, or even things like the type of victims that they are after, or even, you know, things like the commands that they type when they finally breach their targets. So looking at all this information and comparing it and correlating it together, this is the way that we are able to say that we think or we don't think that an attack actually was performed by this group or not.
Why is technical attribution difficult, and what are its limitations?
There are actually two main challenges when it comes to technical attribution. Challenge number one is that the information that we get is partial. We have data that comes from our telemetry mainly, and this means that we only ever see attacks that affect our user base. And so there might be lots of different attacks that are going on and that we do not know about unless somebody publishes about them. So it's difficult for us to build this comprehensive knowledge base of attackers and threat activity, considering that we will never know everything that is going on. The second aspect, which I think is even more challenging, is the ambiguous nature of the information we deal with. That means that, for instance, when we notice that there is some suspicious activity on the machine, then it is entirely possible that there are two separate attackers that are attacking the same victim at the same time, maybe even three or even four, why not? And it's extremely hard for us to separate activity from threat actor number one from activity that is generated by the other threat actor. And finally, there are even more complex cases like false flag attacks where attackers are actively trying to lead us to the wrong conclusions, or even the fact that those backdoors that attackers use can very well be captured by, you know, other groups and be reused. And for us to be able to determine who is who and which is which is the biggest challenge that we have to face, and where the actual knowledge that we build and understanding of the field allows us to provide the best intelligence that we can.
Threat actors don't always create unique malware or attack tools to carry out their attacks. They often resort to commonly available tools or, for instance, backdoors that are employed by other threat actors. This makes it really hard to connect a specific attack to a specific threat actor. On top of that, some high-profile victims may be attacked by multiple actors at the same time. This makes it difficult to separate one attack from another and draw meaningful conclusions about technical attribution. Nastya, could you please tell me what are the risks of incorrect attribution?
Today, it's only states who conduct cyber attribution, so basically to name a culprit behind a cyber attack. But actually, really few people might actually have information on how decision-making is constructed. Therefore, the international community, who could include researchers, civil society, academia, especially those who do policy and legal research in this area, they do not have this information or have really little transparency, again, on the decision-making of states. And therefore, if any inaccuracy or mistake is made in the cyber attribution of states, which is the sovereign right of states, then it will be immediately spill over to others. Then I would also like to highlight with regard to businesses, especially to those who operate in a critical infrastructure and have to procure technology or applications from overseas, their decisions are also inevitably dependent on wider geopolitical consequences where cyber attribution exists as well. So if they have little information about how decisions and which decisions they need to make, then there are little chances that they will make really good security decisions about the ICT procurement in their organizations.
So why would anyone need to have the knowledge of technical attribution?
As it has been mentioned, cyber attribution has a wider implications in terms of the geopolitical realities, and therefore it may really have implications for many, many organizations, not only in government as well. So, and while they have little information on how and why decisions being made in terms of cyber attribution, it's basically one of the possible areas where they could have less information for better security decisions to protect themselves against cyber threats. If international community, again, especially those relevant stakeholders in research community, in academia, in those information security experts and businesses have more opportunity to know about at least technical attribution, then better security decisions they could make, and hopefully they could better protect themselves against cyber threats. Besides, if people are more engaged in a process about how states make decisions in terms of cyber attribution, then hopefully they could have more trust and confidence in the opinion of experts in other states, and that will positively, I believe, will have effect in terms of the more confidence and trust in entire cyberspace as well.
Technical attribution is a complex process during which experts face different challenges and limitations. But this doesn't mean that knowledge of attribution should only be for a select few people. Instead, this information should be as accessible and transparent as possible, leading to stability in the cybersecurity world. Recently, Kaspersky experts, together with third-party researchers, conducted an analysis of what is needed for greater transparency in technical attribution and for greater cooperation with a multi-stakeholder community. To learn more about this process and the latest cybersecurity discoveries, follow the link to our reports on Securelist and don't forget to click the subscribe button.